إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الله به الغمة وجاهد في الله حق جهاده حتى أتاه اليقين فصلوات ربي وتسليماته عليه وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين وصحبه ومن اتبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما إن الله تبارك وتعالى خلقنا لنعبده وحده قال جل جلاله وما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون وجعل السبيل إلى النجاح والفلاح ومرضاته سبحانه طاعته وطاعة نبيه فقال وأطيعوا الله والرسول لعلكم تفلحون واختبر صدق إيماننا به بالفتن والابتلاءات قال جل شأنه ألف لام ميم أحسب الناس أن يتركوا أن يقولوا آمنا وهم لا يفتنون ولقد فتنا الذين من قبلهم فليعلمن الله الذين صدقوا وليعلمن الكاذبين فجعل تعالى هذه الحياة الدنيا دار بلاء لا دار جزاء فقال تبارك الذي بيده الملك وهو على كل شيء قدير الذي خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا وهو العزيز الغفور وجعل شدة البلاء بحسب إيمان المبتلى فكلما قوي إيمان العبد ويقينه بالله تعالى كلما كان البلاء أشد وأصعب لذلك قال تعالى في حق خليله إبراهيم إن ذلك لهو البلاء المبين وعن سعد بن أبي وقاص رضي الله عنه قال قلت يا رسول الله أي الناس أشد بلاء فقال صلى الله عليه وسلم الأنبياء ثم الأمثل فالأمثل فيبتلى الرجل على حسب دينه فإن كان دينه صلبا اشتد بلاؤه وإن كان في دينه رقة ابتلي على حسب دينه فما يبرح البلاء بالعبد حتى يتركه يمشي على الأرض ما عليه خطيئة والابتلاءات تتنوع في طبعها لذلك قال تعالى ولنبلونكم بشيء من الخوف والجوع ونقص من الأموال والأنفس والثمرات وبشر الصابرين الذين إذا أصابتهم مصيبة قالوا إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون أولئك عليهم صلوات من ربهم ورحمة وأولئك هم المهتدون وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عجبا لأمر المؤمن إن أمره كله له خير وليس ذلك لأحد إلا للمؤمن إن أصابته سراء شكر فكان خيرا له وإن أصابته ضراء صبر فكان خيرا له وقال كذلك ما يصيب المسلم من نصب ولا وصب ولا هم ولا حزن ولا أذى ولا غم حتى الشوكة يشاكها إلا كفر الله بها من خطاياه أسأل الله تعالى أن يكفر ذنوبنا وأن يستر عيوبنا ويرفع قدرنا ويرفع درجتنا ومنزلتنا عنده تعالى. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful, we bear witness that there is no God but Allah. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his final messenger. He whom Allah guides, none can misguide. And he whom Allah misguides, none can guide. And we bear witness that there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his final messenger. To proceed, my dear respected brothers, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala created us to worship him. He said, Subhanah, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. And I did not create man and the jinn except but to worship me. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the path to his pleasure and to his countenance and to his mercy and forgiveness and to his gardens, the obedience of his commands and the obedience of his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he said, and obey Allah and his messenger so that you may be successful. And Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala created this life for us as an arena for trials and tests and tribulations, not an arena and not an abode of reward. For the akhirah is the abode of recompense. Imma jannah wa imma nar, either jannah or hellfire wal iyadu billah. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says, الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. He is the one who created death and life to test us. Who amongst us is best in actions? And the scholars, some interpreted best in action, meaning most sincere in his action. But the purpose of our life in this world is to worship Allah, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests our faith in him in this life with many trials. They vary and they are diverse. Trials in health. Health itself is a test and a trial, my dear respected brothers. It is not a reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not, at least not absolutely. For on the day of judgment, from amongst the four things that we will be asked about first is our health, how we exhausted it. And sickness too is a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to see, to try us, to know whether we will be patient and content with his divine will or not. Wealth itself is a test and not a reward from Allah. For if it was a reward from Allah, then Qarun and Fir'aun would be higher than us in rank before the sight of Allah. But this dunya is for the righteous and for the wretched. So Fir'aun was given the dunya and this was no sign of Allah's favor towards him. But rather wealth is a test, my dear respected brothers. Another thing that we will be asked about on the day of judgment before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the first four, that we will be asked about our wealth. From where did we earn it and how did we spend it? And poverty too is a test. And power is a test. To have influence, to have dominance, to have sway, to hold sway, to be able to affect change, our power, how did we use it? To serve mankind, to alleviate suffering, to remove oppression, to establish justice. How did we use that power that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us? And weakness too is a test that most of the prophets experienced and their followers. That will they abandon their faith and their belief because they are subjugated in this life? Or will they remain firm and resolute and rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, trusting that the earth will be inherited by the righteous and by the pious, even if they do not see that in their lifetimes? And Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, he does not test us in vain. For he subhanahu wa ta'ala could have tested us and not given us an explanation and a purpose and an objective behind it. La yus'alu amma yaf'alu wa hum yus'alun. He is not questioned over what he does, and they, meaning mankind, are questioned. So Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala is not questioned, but He Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, from His mercy with us, knowing our limitations that He created us with, He offered for us an explanation and a purpose why. Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, He says, after Alif Lam Mim, did mankind think that they would be left to say we believe and they would not be tested? وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ. And the fitna here, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, the word fitna means linguistically to heat up the metal ore, to remove from it the impurities. So Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala purifies us through these tests and also tests our faith to know whether it is a lip service or not, whether we are saying we believe in Allah and we believe in His Messenger only with our mouths, or whether we have certainty in this. So He says, وَلَقَدْ فَتَنَّ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ, and we tested those who came before them. Thus Allah knows the truthful and He knows the liars. So who are we, in whose camp do we belong? Amongst the truthful or the liars? So Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala tests us to know this. And He knows, Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, the outcome before the test itself, Subhanahu. And the severity of the trials that we experience in this life, my dear respected brothers and sisters, is commensurate with one's iman, one's faith in Allah, and one's yaqeen, his certainty in Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. It is in proportion. And that is why the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he was asked by Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, he was asked, O Messenger of Allah, who is the most severe in trials? Meaning, who receives the most severe trials? So the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, the prophets. Then those who are closest to them, then those who are closest to them. So the highest rank before the sight of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala amongst His slaves, those who have won Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala's favor, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, He tests them with the most severe of tests. And the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he continues in this hadith telling Sa'd radiallahu anhu, he said to him, so the man is tested according to his religion. If his religion is strong and firm, the test is increased for him. And if his religion is soft, then he will be tested according to his religion. And the test will not end except that Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala has expiated all of his sins. Allahu Akbar. That his sins will be removed at the end of that test. With the condition that he is successful, of course. That he does not object to Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala's will. He does not give up, but rather he submits to Allah and is content with his divine will, Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. And if we look at the prophets, Ibrahim alayhi salam was tested, the greatest and most manifest test, as Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala describes it, when he was commanded to sacrifice his firstborn, his only born at the time, when he saw in the dream that he is sacrificing his son Ismail. And both of them submitted to Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala and went through with the command, obeying Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala without question, knowing that Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala will not neglect them, and he does not will and he does not command anything in vain, but rather for a purpose and for an objective and a wisdom. Even if we cannot perceive this wisdom, we trust that Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala has reserved great reward and great benefit through that test. And Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, He saved Ismail, testing his father's faith and testing his faith too. And the prophets being the greatest amongst mankind, and who greater than the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the master of the first and the last, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, was tested, my dear respected brothers, in every regard. He was tested with weakness. And when we say weakness, we mean influence and power. He was tested where his followers were tortured before his eyes and he could do nothing, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. The Messenger was tested in his honor when his wife was accused of adultery, our mother Aisha, falsely accused, of course. He was tested in his character and his uprightness when he was called a liar. He was called a sorcerer and he was called majnoon, crazy. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. All of the prophets, my dear respected brothers, were tested with wealth and with poverty, with illness. Ayyub alayhi salam, who suffered great illness and he was patient and lost all of his children. And despite all of that, he remained patient before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala tells us in regards to the range of trials that one may experience, he says, and we وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ and we will indeed, we will surely test you with some loss. And we will surely test you with some fear and hunger and loss in wealth and your lives and in your harvest. وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ but give glad tidings to the patient. الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ those who are afflicted with a calamity, a catastrophe, they do not lose hope. They say, to Allah we belong and to Him we shall return. أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ صَلَوَاتٌ مِّن رَبِّهِمْ وَرَحْمَةٌ who are those people are the ones who will receive from Allah salutations and the prayers and salutations from Allah is mercy and forgiveness for us, of course. وَرَحْمَةٌ and mercy, وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُهْتَدُونَ and those indeed are the truly guided. So how then can we lose hope? How then can we turn away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when He has tested us to raise us? Subhanahu wa ta'ala. The believer, he rejoices. وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ Allah says, and give glad tidings to the patient. Therefore, the tested, the tried individual should rejoice in knowing this. And therefore the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, wonderful is the state of the believer. Indeed, all his affairs for him are good. If he is affected with prosperity, he's grateful to Allah. He thanks Allah and that is good for him. And if he is afflicted with adversity, he is patient and that too is good for him. That is the state of the believer. Whether it is good, whether what he experiences is something that is perceived good or something that is perceived bad, something perceived evil by human standards, we should know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, only good is attributed to Him, so anything that affects us is for our benefit. How can we achieve such a level? How can we achieve such a state? It is not an easy state to reach, my dear respected brothers. It requires knowledge. To know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to know, to learn about His religion, to learn His book that took us from darkness into light, who took us, the book that guided us to prosperity and happiness in this life and in the next. To learn the life of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To learn his ahadith, to learn his guidance. For he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he did not leave us to go astray. He did not leave us in darkness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, about his messenger, هو الذي يصلي عليكم وملائكته ليخرجكم من الظلمات إلى النور وكان بالمؤمنين رحيما. He, the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, prays upon you, asking Allah of course for forgiveness and mercy, and his angels do so too, ليخرجكم من الظلمات إلى النور, to remove you from darkness and take you into light. وَكَانَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَحِيمًا and he was with the believers merciful. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what do we know about his life, about his dealings, his interactions, his character, his sayings, how he gave his followers hope, how he guided them, how he steered them? If we do not know this, but we know about other individuals in history or even contemporary figures who may not even offer guidance, but in fact offer misguidance, how then will we deal and stand firm in the face of the difficulties and the hardships that will inevitably affect us in life? And a small metaphor may highlight this matter. With more knowledge, there is more patience. The more knowledge a person has, the more grateful, in fact, he has. The more grateful he is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Take, for example, a child who is taken to a doctor or to a dentist. The dentist will put him in the chair and he will recline him and pry his mouth open. And he will have to inflict pain onto that patient, that young patient, so that he can improve his situation, so that he may treat him, so that he may prevent any further damage to that child's teeth in the future. That child, not knowing the objective of this gruesome procedure as he perceives it, he shakes and he objects and he screams and he cries, because he doesn't know that this procedure and this treatment is for his benefit and his interest. But take a mature adult who knows that he must experience some temporary pain for long-term health benefits. He will remain patient in the chair. He will experience pain, but he will not object. And at the end, not only has he shown patience, he will thank the doctor for having treated him. Then what then is the case of the believer with Allah, who experiences some temporary hardship, but he knows in the future it is for his benefit? Even if he can't see that future benefit, he's reliant upon Allah, that Allah has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been appointed his affairs, and that he is the best appointee. So therefore he submits and he surrenders to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with full trust and reliance upon him. And we conclude with a hadith where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, never is a believer stricken with a discomfort or illness or anxiety or grief or sadness, even the prick of a thorn, except that Allah will expiate his sins. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us knowledge and to grant us patience and to grant us contentment, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expiate our sins and raise our station before his eyes and grant us the company of his Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. إن الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على الحبيب المصطفى وبعد. It may be that the most frequent affliction that strikes us in this life is sickness and illness. That our health is affected every now and then, sometimes severely and sometimes with mild conditions. And with our extended lifespans and increased longevity, my dear respected brothers and sisters, as we all know, there are conditions that are associated with age. Not least, and the most vicious amongst the diseases and conditions, is cancer. Cancer that affects 2.5 million people in the UK. A number that will only increase, as it is projected, to 4 million by the year 2030. And we are not spared this disease by virtue of being Muslims. Every one of us knows an individual, whether they are family or friends or brief acquaintances, who have wrestled with this disease and struggled and suffered at its hands. And even with strong iman and conviction and certainty that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will alleviate the difficulty, if not in this life, then in the next, even with this strong faith, my dear respected brothers and sisters, it is very difficult to navigate this new terrain for somebody who is affected with cancer, or somebody whose family member suffers from cancer. First of all, as Muslims, we must know, as the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that what afflicts us could never have missed us, and what misses us could never have afflicted us. This is the first position we should have when we hear the news that we have been diagnosed, or a family member has been diagnosed, or a friend has been diagnosed with cancer. And we should also utilize the charities that are specialized in offering cancer support, whether to the patients or to their families. Those like Macmillan. Macmillan Cancer Support that is launching this weekend a coffee morning. A coffee morning where they raise money. Macmillan in 2016 alone gave £160 million towards cancer support and services, including nurses for the patients, helplines for patients and for their families and anybody affected. Research towards fighting cancer and finding a cure and offering financial grants also to those who are affected and require grants. And my dear respected brothers and sisters, those who use Macmillan are not all non-Muslim. There are Muslims who utilize their services and they benefit from them. But what a shame it is that our levels of contributions do not match the level of service that they provide. And the believer must give and cooperate. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى, and cooperate ye with one another in piety, in righteous deeds and in piety. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, دَاوُوا مَرْضَاكُمْ بِالصَّدَقَةِ, cure your ill, your sick ones with charity. Tomorrow they have a coffee breakfast. If you are unable to attend, then please contribute towards it. Contribute towards it even with a cake that the slices of which will be sold for the charity. Or give a cash donation, as we will be doing inshallah. Take part and participate. Be part of the solution. And let us not only enjoy the services that are offered to us, but we are part of that solution and part of the effort to alleviate the suffering of everyone, all of mankind. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give patience to those affected with disease, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant them a full and speedy recovery and give their families patience and comfort and solace and support and console them in this difficult time. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes us constructive members of this society and everywhere in His creation. هذا وصلوا وسلموا على خير الأنام فإن الله أمركم بأمر بدأ به بنفسه وثنى بملائكة قدسه ثم بكم أيها المؤمنون فقال جل من قائل إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين وأذل الشرك والمشركين وأعلي بفضلك كلمتي الحق والدين اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه عباد الله رحمكم الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله العظيم يذكركم واشكروه على نعمه يزد لكم ولذكر الله تعالى أعلى وأولى وأهم وأتم وأجل وأكبر وأقم الصلاة.